Chances are that you live in a country whose money supply is controlled by a privately owned central bank. They have lofty names that attempt to give them a veneer of credibility and being part of the public trust. The Federal Reserve in the US, for example. And other than being able to appoint a minority of members to the Board of Governors in some instances, central banks are mostly independent from national governments. These private institutions create the money supply out of nothing, and the money they create is backed by nothing. The Federal Reserve came into existence a little over 100 years ago and was formed by and in the interests of the private banks. And in this time, the dollar has devalued by 96% and national debt has grown 5,000 times larger. And finally, in March 2008, then-chairman Ben Bernanke admitted that just 16 years after the Fed was created, it caused the Great Depression that ended in the Second World War. Oops, sorry, we won't do that again, he said, as the Fed has learned its lesson. The Fed is privately owned and its shareholders are private banks. Who those shareholders are is mostly unknown as this information is made as opaque as possible. However, most investigations by independent researchers all point to the Rothschilds banking dynasty as being the key prime mover. One of the first things the United States has done when it invaded countries in the name of freedom in this century was to enslave the populations with debt via central banks owned by global banking cartels that are integrated into the global financial system. In 2001, the US invaded Afghanistan, and by 2003, Da Afghan Bank was established by presidential decree, that president being Hamid Karzai, the man with ties to UNICAL, and was installed by the US a couple of months after the invasion. Just a few months after the invasion of Iraq, the US did not even wait for the cover of a puppet government and created the Central Bank of Iraq to, in their words, bring Iraq's legal framework for banking in line with international standards. Or in layman's terms, the US as an occupying power foisted upon the people of Iraq a privately controlled central bank, which then began to issue debt. And just an aside, I have done a video previously on why Libya under Muammar Gaddafi was destroyed as he attempted to implement a gold-backed currency that would be outside the central bank system and would have challenged the petrodollar. Depending on your sources, the countries outside the Rothschild central banking system are very small indeed and make up a very interesting group. The two remaining members of the Axis of Evil, North Korea and Iran, as well as the country with the longest sustained economic sanctions that the US has applied to anywhere in the world, Cuba, and the broken and devastated nation of Syria, where the US has backed rebel groups that seek to overthrow the regime, despite the horrific crimes against the Syrian people they have committed. It's absolutely clear that many of the central banks of the world are controlled by private banking cartels. However, there is no institutional will, despite the obvious problems that exist with a private institution having the power to create debt-backed currencies out of nothing and then loan it at interest. And I can think of nowhere in the world where there is a political movement to break and shut down a national central bank. As politics in the West are focused on things like guns, abortion, LGBTQ rights, feminism, failing schools, drugs, soft and hard, race relations, the failing welfare state, and mass uncontrolled immigration from developing nations that is supposed to fix all of this. It seems hard to understand why governments that are supposed to put the security and safety of its citizens as its top priority, whether that be physical or financial, have so willfully negated their responsibility. Central banks control the money supply, but it is commercial banks that create most of the money via fractional reserve banking, meaning banks only hold a fraction of the amount of its deposit liabilities. It creates money by loaning out money they do not have at interest, and thereby creating debt. Voila. Our currencies are created in debt, and our debt, whether personal or public, is created out of nothing. So why do governments throughout the Western world speak of the dire horrors that await a country that does not expand its population? With falling population, banks have fewer people to issue debt to, and even more difficult for banks is that most throughout the Western world are maxed out on their ability to carry more debt. Canada holds more personal debt than the citizens of any other G7 country, and its cities have some of the most overvalued real estate on the planet. The same is for Australians, who, not part of the G7, are in fact the most indebted people in the world. Canadians in Canada and Australians in Australia are milked populations. You would have more luck drawing water from a stone than finding populations that are so thoroughly owned via debt service slavery. Ever wonder why Canada and Australia are so eager to allow hundreds of thousands of new debt slaves to enter their countries every year, despite high unemployment, deteriorating services, and the destruction of social cohesion? None of this matters, as Canada and Australia, like the rest of the West, keep pumping new cogs into the debt machine. Mass immigration of people from the developing world who lack language skills as well as formal education also keeps the labor market artificially high and depresses wages. The gutting of the middle class everywhere and the creation of McJobs forces people into endless years of seeking credentialism in the hope of getting a better job, thus more student loans and more debt. More people struggling means more people on government assistance, which means more people will vote to expand welfare benefits, thus more national debt. Without an expanding population, banks lose, as they have less ability to issue debt that is created out of nothing via fractional reserve banking. The more immigration that is foisted on a country from the developing world, the more the political compass moves toward expanding the welfare state. From a certain point, it will become almost impossible for the bankers and their political puppets to be dislodged. These same cartels control most of the institutions, and this is also why the election of Donald Trump was so unexpected. However, with the continued demographic and thus political shift in the US as well as the rest of the Western world, democratic nations with populations that are impoverished through this system will move to ever less free and more overtly controlled societies, and this will end the ability to effect change peacefully. And should there be any violence or the fashionably new blasphemous crime in the West, intergroup feelings of hate or resentment in the pressure cooker that has been created, then it provides even more license for overt totalitarian measures and the shift to an open police state. And the destruction of your society is all the result of a small group of people, their greed, and lust for power. Banking reform and the elimination of debt-backed currencies is probably one of the most important issues in the world today, and it is never spoken about because those that rule you also fool you with their bought and paid for controlled media and political class. And also, I will be making, if this video proves successful, a video delineating the value of government-backed currency rather than debt-backed currency. And for a very meticulous look at debt-backed currencies, central banks, and the history of banking subversion of the money supply in Europe and the US, please see this excellent video by Bill Still called The Money Masters. And as always, thank you for watching. If you like this video, please consider subscribing. Also follow us on the usual media and see our website, blackpigeonspeaks.com, for more and interesting information like this.